Good evening, everyone, those who are here in our shul, in Beit Knesset Hanasi in Yerushalayim, and a good day to everyone that finds themselves in a different place. Tonight I want to talk about the book that I have just written and published. The book is called In My Opinion. And the subtitle is that these are insights and essays on topics of interest by a very opinionated rabbi. Now, I want to tell you a personal background to all of this. When I had my second bar mitzvah a number of years ago, so I had in mind that there were three more books that I wanted to get out from within me. So one book was the book about Eliyahu HaNavi, In the Footsteps of Eliyahu HaNavi, the book about the Jewish exile, all the places of the Jewish exile. This is the second book that I had in me. It's, and I'm going to discuss it and describe it. And there's a third book that I am working on that I hope the Lord will allow me to complete. And that's about the story of the Orthodox Jewish community over the 19th and 20th centuries. It's a revival and resurgence and the different trends that exist within it. Anyway, I was told by the Ponovizhia Rav a long time ago. I remember he was in Miami Beach, I think it was 1966 or 67, and he was raising money for his institutions. And one day he told me, you know, he's starting a new institution in Ashdod, Yeshivat Grodna. He's going to rebuild in Ashdod. So I, in my naivete, said to him, Rebbe, you know, we're struggling with Bnei Brak, with supporting the yeshiva in Bnei Brak. Were you building another yeshiva? I remember that when my wife was pregnant with our third child, so I told our oldest child, you know, Mama's going to have a baby. And she said, what do we need another baby for? We didn't use up this one yet. So what do we need another yeshiva for? We didn't use up this one yet. And he told me, he said, I want to tell you a secret. That if you always start new projects, if you're always doing something, and then the Malach in heaven will say, you know, he's in the middle, we'll let him finish. So they won't bother you. If you say, I'm finished, you know, that's it. Oh, so then the Malach said, well, then, you know, we used him up, so we don't have to do anything more for him. And that has remained with me my entire life. I've always tried to be in the middle of something. So this is a very personal book. Most of my books are not personal, meaning they're history. I have books in halacha. I have books of thought, of commentary, but this is a very personal book. The only other personal book that I've written is my autobiography, and I wrote that because I didn't want someone else to write it, and I chose what I would say and what I would omit. But this is a personal book because this is really what I think. Now, many times when a person is in public life, persons are of, or it's true of political leaders as well. Anytime, anybody, the head of a corporation, the head of a university, even a Rosh Yeshiva, you can't always say what you really think. There are pressures. There are all sorts of reasons why you should withhold your opinion. It's not politic to reveal it. But when you reach a certain age, thank God, and you're in a situation where really it doesn't make that much difference. I would like people to think well of me, but I don't take a poll every day to find out if they do think well of me. I'm not impressed by the fact that there may be people who have a different opinion than I do. I learned that from my mother of blessed memory. I remember I that so-and-so said this and this about me. I must have been 8 years old, 9 years old. And I felt badly. And she said to me, so he said it, so what? In fact, she said it in Yiddish to make it stronger. Oter gesagt. He said it. And that made a very strong impression upon me. So one has to always be aware of what others think and say, but one need not be controlled by what others think and say. Because at the end of the day, we are all our own person, and we're judged by being our own person. So over my many years, I've developed a lot of opinions about issues. I don't always express them publicly because of the fact that I cannot say that I am right or that my opinion should be followed. But I value my own opinion, how I look at things. And over my lifetime, I've always written down my opinions. Now, some of them I have revised and changed. If you can't change your opinion, you're useless. Many times the problem is that people think that what they say are right is written in stone and can never be changed. That's not true. You certainly can change your opinion. But my Rebbe taught me a long time ago, he said, you may be right or you may be wrong, but you have to have an opinion. You have to judge the matter. And then time and circumstance and society generally will judge your opinion, whether it's of value to them, whether it should be followed. And even he said, he taught me, he said, even if you want to ignore it, you should at least hear it. If you saw Salanter in his genius, looked at the verse in Tehillim that we say in Mizvah Shir Liyom HaShabbos. So we say, "Bakomim alayim reim tishmano oznoi." when people who come to do me harm, let my ears hear them. So the simple explanation is I should be forewarned. I should know in advance what my enemies are planning. We call that intelligence. But he gave it a different twist. He said, "Bakomi malai mereim," when people come to say criticism of me, when they come to hold me to a task, "Tishmana oznoi," let my ears hear what they have to say. Maybe they have a point. To be able to take into account what others say. So you will find in this book, most of these essays are what I think about what others are thinking. Sometimes I agree with them, sometimes I don't, but I have always tried to listen to what others have to say, because that's how a person grows. If you made up your mind, I remember that I once worked for someone and he had a sign on his desk, the boss, that he said, "Don't confuse me with the facts. My mind is made up." And that's true of so many people. And of such, it's true in the political world that we live in now. My mind is made up. Doesn't make any difference what the facts are. And it's true in the personal world. I don't like him. So if I don't like him, I'm not willing to listen to one word that he has to say. And that narrows me, that shrinks me, that corrodes me. So in order to have healthy opinions, I think one needs a broad perspective. You have to be able to see more than one side of the problem. Now, we all come with our personal biases. We all come with our personal ideas. And many of them are preset from almost infancy. Depends how we were raised, where we were raised, what were the circumstances of our childhood and education. But as a person grows in the world, then there has to be a wider perspective. And it is in this wider perspective that our opinions are formed. So I have a chapter here, for instance, called Israel the Beautiful, about the state of Israel, about Eretz Yisrael, about the land, about the government, about the people. So it depends how you look at it. If you want to, you can look at it very negatively. 100 things wrong. But my opinion is that Israel is beautiful. It's a beautiful country. Look what has been accomplished. And don't forget, I'm writing from the perspective of someone who was born before there was a state of Israel. I know I have often spoken to my grandchildren. They cannot imagine a world without the state of Israel. What do you mean? I'm going to go to be bar mitzvah at the Kotel. Go tell them there was no Kotel. Go tell them there was no way to get there. So one's opinion is formed by these types of circumstances. And I have I had another drive here, and that is that I really wrote this book for my generations. Thank the Lord, somehow my family became a tribe. Can I know her? I'm an only son, and I just cannot fathom the gratitude that I have. Yaakov Avinu said, "Givamakli avarti esayarde nazeh." I crossed this Jordan only with a staff. I was alone. Ve'ato yisi lishnei machanos. And now I am a double encampment. That's such a blessing. But I would like that my great-grandchildren should know what I thought about certain things so that they could consider it. That they would also think about it. And I'm here in Israel and they're in America and they're 11, 12 years old and going to school and I don't have any real contact with them. The job of grandparents and great-grandparents is to send the check for the birthday. But how do you have a connection? And that was one of the forces that drove me to write and publish this book, so that at least they would know what I thought about certain issues. And it's interesting that the issues here are timeless, because they recur, shebechol dor v'dor. They repeat themselves over and over again, sometimes in different forms, different circumstances. Nothing is the same. Technology moves on. But human nature is the same. It's never changed since the Garden of Eden. And therefore, it's important that they should hear from a far distant voice. A generation that once was, there are not many around for my generation anymore at all. But it's important that they should hear it. And Chazal say always in the tradition of Torah and the Jewish people that people were transmitters of what went before, so that what came later had something to be based upon. You should not think that somehow all the problems are new problems and that they cannot handle them. I remember when I was the head of my yeshiva in Muncie, so I used to give an orientation lecture to the ninth grade boys when they entered. And it was a pretty frank discussion. I always believed in not hiding issues, not pretending holiness where it didn't exist. So I spoke to them, and one of the things that I said is that they should know that girls existed before them, and that it's not a new problem. And therefore, they'd be wise to listen to what older people had to say on the subject. And I think that's true of many, many things. You have an attempt now in the United States to rewrite the entire history of the United States, as though the past never occurred. Well, if the past never occurred and we're going to erase it, then the future is going to be worthless, because there's nothing to build upon and nothing to improve. And all of history has shown us that that is true. And that's why Moshe Rabbeinu said, Zchor Yemos Olam Binu Shnos Dor Vador. Remember the past. Understand the generations. Understand what's alike and what's different. Shalavicha V'yageitcha. Ask your father and he'll tell you. So the parents tell children their lives and their experiences, But there's more than that. Schenecha v'yomar lach. The elders, the old ones. Let them tell you what was. Then you'd have an appreciation. So I remember in my lifetime, I knew European Jews. I had a sense of what European Jews were about. Now that's something that my grandchildren and great-grandchildren cannot have, simply because of the passage of time. But if somehow that can be communicated to them, because many of the opinions in this book are based on the ideas and the lifestyle and values that Eastern European Jews had, and that somehow I was fortunate enough that it was communicated to me, and it was communicated in a way that I didn't even realize. When I saw my great teachers, they weren't great teachers in my eyes. Rebbe. 40 years later, I figured out what a great man he was. So opinions grow that way as well. And therefore, this book, as I mentioned, is a very personal book, because to a great extent it tells about me, and not only about my opinions. Now, because this was such a personal book, I could not find a publisher that would publish it, because of the fact that somehow there are 150 different essays in the book. It's 360 pages long. So one publisher, he said, you know, we'd like to publish it, but you got to take this essay out, because it will rub my readership the wrong way. And another publisher said it about a different essay. And I've been in the book business, quote unquote, for many, many decades, and I know that the author never gets rich from it. Especially in the Jewish field. So I decided I'm going to do what I want to do. I'm going to publish the opinions I want to publish. And I was fortunate enough that a number of people helped finance the book, because without that, I would have not been able to publish it at all. And I found one of the local geniuses here in Jerusalem, a treasure that should be appreciated, Ben Gassner, who is talented beyond words. And he produces books, mostly self-publishing, but other books as well. So I decided I'm going to let Gassner do it, and I'll self-publish the book. And whatever happens, happens. That's all right. And the book has been released in the United States for at least 2.5 months. And it's done very well in America, meaning that most of the books that we ship to America are gone already. Here we postponed the launch because of the corona and the lockdown, and then I was away for a few months. But now I've decided that the book should be here as well. And the book is food for thought. You don't have to agree with it. though by now you know I'm always right. But it'll give you things to think about. And if people think, so then that's our job. Rabos machshovos b'lev ish. People have many thoughts. If you have many thoughts, eventually v'atzas Hashem yisokum. One of the thoughts will be holy, will be from heaven. But if you never think about anything, if you're just an automaton, you get up in the morning and that's it, and you know, and never give consideration to anything. So then the Atzas Hashem is not likely to fall into the purview of your thought. But if you use your mind and your brains, so then Torah, the Atzas Hashem, goodness, holiness, purpose, always somehow penetrates and becomes part of you. So that's what I wanted to tell you tonight. And I really appreciate those that came here, and we had to limit it because of the coronavirus. So each one of you is 1,000. The Nanovi says, Akotan yel elef, va'atsoyer legoyotzum. Each Jew is 1,000. So we filled up the stadium here tonight. And books will be available. And for those who are on Zoom and want to get the book, in Israel, you can get them from Rabbi Nochum Amsel, and his phone is 054-454-3618, and he will take care of it for you. And in the United States, you can get it through my office of Destiny. And its phone number is 800-499-WEIN, W-E-I-N, 9346. And I hope that you will get the book, and that you'll read it. And I would love to hear your comments. And I want to wish you all good health and happiness, and really thank you all for your support and for coming. Good evening, everyone. Good day, everyone.